So, Peter, thanks for inviting me. I have to admit, I think my presentation will be a bit different from the previous one. I've also told me that maybe I should say some words about ESA in general, what we do. For that, I think I would...
Go right.
Right. Okay. I would maybe expand a bit on the background of the things that I've worked on, and then I talk about some graph issues that we have in the ground segment and in scientific workflows. None of them probably have the scale that you've been used to. So my background is originally scientific data processing and simulation, mostly in the past 10 years or so. I've done some work in the area of databases in Peter's shop. At ESA, I've mainly worked in space operations. So the Rosetta spacecraft, that was a mission to a comet that finished last September. And for about 2 years, I've mainly worked in the Earth Observation Ground segment for Copernicus data. So it's clear that for me, ESA mainly deals with two types of missions. One is scientific missions, one is monitoring missions. In monitoring missions, you have the comparatively large data volumes, that are produced by the systematic monitoring of the Earth through the various Sentinel radar imaging and later on atmospheric missions. The scientific missions tend to be very different. They tend to have a long history. So when I heard in the previous presentation that you had a machine with, that you were using a machine with 1 terabyte, so this is about twice the theoretical data volume that the Rosetta spacecraft could produce. So there the spacecraft bus had a physical limitation, had a technical limitation of about 100 kilobits per second. We indeed worked with these units, kilobit per second, which approximately translates to a gigabyte per day, and which happens to coincide with the maximum bandwidth that a NASA 70-meter antenna can actually downlink from a spacecraft. Yes. So in these scientific missions, the numbers are very different, the scales are very different, and also the way of working is very different. A lot of things are done on a best effort basis. So whereas, at least in theory, for the monitoring missions, we have very well-defined workflows, which probably would not lend themselves very nicely to producing graph models and describe everything in a very structured fashion. In the scientific missions, we often have cases that atmospheric models are produced on a best effort basis by PhD students. So if you want to have a nice calibration of your optical images, you often depend on the schedule of the university holidays. Yes. So when Hinek sent me this the invitation to this conference, I actually started thinking, do we do much with graphs at ESA? And then I thought, okay, we sort of do the standard stuff. I mean, we have our management processes defined as graph flows, responsibilities of people, interactions between governing bodies, etc., operation procedures. It's the standard practice. And then, so that's probably not very exciting for you. We use these standard IT tools for intrusion protection. This is really just off the shelf stuff that is being deployed. But then I wondered, is there really any technical use that is native to our domain? And the two things that I eventually came up with were product generation and reprocessing campaigns. So imagine just a few weeks ago, those of you who are interested in the Sentinel-2 imaging satellite noticed that a lot of data were reprocessed from the commissioning campaign. So commissioning is sort of the phase between when a satellite is launched and when it's in fully operational use, and it's a phase that is being used to characterize the instrument, to learn to operate the satellite best, and to get a feeling for how operations are implemented most efficiently, etc. And it's a time where you do not know everything about the satellite you need to know to produce science quality. I touch this keyboard more often. to produce science grade data. And what happened was that now during the approximately 2 years of Sentinel-2 operations, the operations teams learned so much about the satellite that they were able to produce much better data, to calibrate data much better, data that was taken during the during the commissioning campaign, so that they eventually could arrive at the same science grade quality as operational data. And that's why what we call a reprocessing campaign was done, and a lot of new products, all the old products, were put out. I know, just one remark, I know that spacecraft trajectories are very often displayed as graphs. However, I mean, it's sort of a very nice visual representation, but this is actually not how they're planned and produced, in my experience. So spacecraft trajectories are notoriously complicated things. So the trajectory is, of course, let's say a function that sort of maps time to a location in some coordinate system. It's usually intrinsically connected to what we call the spacecraft attitude, sort of that is where the satellite really looks at. Satellites have numerous constraints, like it is not allowed for the sun to shine at a particular angle at one side of the spacecraft for more than, let's say, 20 minutes, because the spacecraft would overheat. And so what happens is usually that these trajectories are integrated in a sort of Monte Carlo fashion, step by step, which you could describe probably with a graph, but it'd be more complicated. So what I thought was more relevant, especially now that we have these big monitoring missions that we implement in the Copernicus program for the European Commission, which do produce at least quite a lot of data, at least much more data than the space community has been used to, is how we could sort of use graph theory to reason about what happens between these products. Do we really have to start a reprocessing campaign that means sort of follow a very nicely organized procedure to improve our data, or can we do this in a more flexible fashion? For a year or so, we've tried to build a big data platform, maybe not by new standards, but big by our standards. So we're talking about, you know, 2 to 10 petabytes, depending on how you count here. We asked ourselves these questions. So I should say that the space community in general is very conservative. I've mentioned the Rosetta mission. From beginning to end, this mission had a lifetime of about 30 years, so it's really a multiple cycles of technology development. It essentially started with a big success in the 1980s, where Europe had a mission called Jota that flew by a Comet heli back then. And they just wanted to have something on top of this, not only do a flyby of a comet, be in the vicinity of the comet for a couple of minutes, something we say seconds, but rather have a mission that stays close to a comet for an extended amount of time. And so they decided to build Rosetta, to do the research that is necessary to build an operated spacecraft, fly to the comet, which took 7 years, 10 years alone, and then spend about 2.5 years very close to the comet. And these things do have implications. So the long project duration means that the presence of technology within the project is important. When you organize such a project, we look at people who have organized such big projects in the past. So you have usually a heritage that comes from the military domain, with the respective strictness of rules, etc. But let me now just give you some ideas about how we generate products. So we recently built a system that generates advanced synthetic aperture radar products on the fly, in this case from own missions, but that is a detail. Radar data are usually stored as level zero strip lines as they were from the detector of the instrument, and then store and then process according to various polarization modes, etc., that make radar data quite complex. And here you see sort of a system diagram how this is used. So you see here auxiliary data, you see a dynamic processing management facility, and you see at the bottom a number of processing nodes that do the actual processing. And the thing is that the configuration of this can be different for every product that is being generated. So in some sense, if you look at the right part of this image, this can be different for every single product. Inducing a very nice dependency graph with many interesting patterns. So to give you an idea of the scale of the problem that we're having here, so this is just an overview that I copied off the web 2 days ago, I think, by the size of our repositories. So we have, roughly 2 million products there. And currently the repository of the base products is here, 1.4 petabyte. And it's constantly increasing. You would have such a schematic graph for every product that is derived, actually, from any one of these. eventually the challenge that we face is how to give people sensible access to this product. So this is actually the area we are in. I was looking for the last cloud-free image recorded by Sentinel-2, and unfortunately this apparently was only beginning of December last year. And this is the kind of thing that we would like to be able to do, to generate from the base data through a chain, something that can be presented to a user and lead him or her to further research. Okay, I think I'm running out of time, but I've just listed here a number of challenges with respect to how to treat higher level products, as we call them, with respect to the underlying level zero and level one products, and mentioned materialization of products, reprocessing components. Can we do them automatically, or do we have to organize them? Can we estimate the impact of updates in different levels of the products, et cetera, et cetera? Do we have to store everything, which can become expensive, or can we compute things just in time? I also want to mention that we have some tools that use graphs to describe scientific workflows. This is just a bit of a screenshot, what you can see on the screen. This is an example of Sentinel-1 processing. If we look like this, there's a little preview in the lower left corner, maximal representation of the graph, and the graph that you just saw in the previous slide on the top right. For this advanced synthetic aperture radar, just to give you an impression, the user face in front and would look like this. So it would all be sort of working behind the scenes. Okay, and this is essentially what I wanted to tell you, these are my thoughts about ESA and graph databases, hopefully very preliminary, followed up by somebody. Thanks, Peter.
Yeah, thanks, Albert. Maybe I'm just mystified myself, but the exact connection to graph data is not really clear to me. But maybe, so have you actually worked with graph databases?
This ASA processing example there, I think we had a case where we used commercial products plan, which looked into this processing chain, mm-hmm. and basically helped our facility operators sort of helped us to find out where processing has gone wrong.
Okay.
And
right. Splunk I know is some kind of log process in terms
yes, exactly.
of
environment. Sort of, you read in logs from various machines, you correlate them and build a graph.
Okay. Well, I should not ask the question myself. I should let you ask questions, of course. So, are there any questions?
I had heard about a partnership between ESA and HANA, this HANA team for spatial and graph engines. I was wondering if you could comment about that.
I mean, my involvement has not gone so far, I think, that I can talk about this, but maybe, I don't know,
Yeah, I can just comment on it. So we have a kind of partnership with the European Space Agency. It's related to Earth observation data. And we are using our spatial engine to process it, and here we are also looking into graph topologies, because you can, for instance, extract topologies out of satellite images, like a street network, and you can use it to improve open street map, and then you can do routing and these kind of things. That's why graph and spatial are really fitting very good together, and why we are working together with the European Space Agency.
Okay, thanks. Any other questions? Yeah.
Do you plan having any kind of operations and computation with the scientific workflows, or with some kind of like optimizing them, or?
Not really. I mean, this Sentinel-1 workflow was really one bit in a larger workflow. So what people tend to do is they tend to do their processing on these radar data, then store the product somewhere, and then use a separate workflow on the resulting product. I also have to admit that, all the, let's say, professionals that I've talked to, they never use this graph representation of the workflow. They tend to generate the XML directly through scripts, but it's still, it's still used for communicating ideas, etc.
Okay, well, let's thank